were indeed buried with him through our baptism into death.
Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb
and to prepare them and prepare us for that seventh and most important sign is what we celebrate tonight, Jesus' resurrection from the dead.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Welcome to our celebration of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. Before we enter into the solemnity of the celebration, I would just like to tell you a little funny story. My first year here, this is my third now, my first year here, when we did the Easter fire, there was a rusty half barrel that we lit the Easter fire in. And so I said to Father Gene, any of you remember Father Gene, a part of the building? Yes. How many of you remember Father Gene?
Yes.
I said, well, Gene, you know, in current churches, they build a particular special designated place for the Easter fire. I said, and St. James so new, I'm wondering, why didn't you do that? And those of you who know Father Gene will understand this. He said, all that money for one night? So we are most grateful that one of our Eagle Scouts made this his Eagle Scout project, Austin Lepak, and his family was very involved, his fellow scouts and friends. And so now we are blessed with a very worthy place to celebrate the new light of Christ among us. And the most fantastic great I've ever seen. It's a very great great. Thanks to John Simon, our maintenance person. So he did an excellent job with that, and it's just perfect. And the scouts saw this evening as well, building this fantastic fire, a very worthy fire, to help us recall Christ, our light. Dear brothers and sisters, on this most sacred night, in which our Lord Jesus Christ passed over from death to life, the Church calls upon her sons and daughters scattered throughout the world to come together to watch and to pray. If we keep the memorial of the Lord's Paschal solemnity in this way, listening to his word and celebrating his mysteries, then we shall have the sure hope of sharing his triumph over death and living with him in God. Let us pray. O God, who through your Son bestowed upon the faithful the fire of your glory, sanctify this new fire and grant that by these Paschal celebrations we may be so inflamed with heavenly desires that with minds made pure, we may attain festivities of unending splendor through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you. as we focus our prayer on the Easter candle about to be lit from the new Easter fire, please repeat each invocation after me. Christ, yesterday and today.
Christ, yesterday and today.
The beginning and the end.
The beginning and the end.
The Alpha and the Omega.
The Alpha and the Omega.
All time belongs to Him.
All time belongs to Him.
And all the ages.
And all the ages.
To Him be glory and power.
To Him be glory and power.
Through every age and forever, amen.
Through every age and forever, amen.
By His holy and glorious wounds.
By His holy and glorious wounds.
May Christ the Lord guard us and protect us, amen.
May Christ the Lord guard us and protect us, amen.
Thank you. This is the night when Jesus Christ Christ broke the chains of death and rose triumphant from the grave. What good would life have been to us had Christ not come as our Redeemer? Father, how wonderful your care for us, how boundless your merciful love. To ransom a slave, you gave away your son. O happy fault, O necessary sin of Adam, which gained for us so great a Redeemer. Most blessed of all nights, chosen by God to see Christ rising from the dead. Of this night, Scripture says, the night will be clear as day. It will become my light, my joy. The power of this holy night dispels all evil, washes guilt away, restores lost innocence, brings mourners joy. It casts out hatred, brings us peace, and humbles earthly pride. Night truly blessed, when heaven is wedded to earth, and we are reconciled with God. Therefore, Heavenly Father, in the joy of this night, receive our evening sacrifice of praise, your church's solemn offering. Accept this Easter candle, a fire divided but undimmed, a pillar of fire that glows to the honor of God. Let it mingle with the lights of heaven and continue bravely burning to dispel the darkness of this night. May the morning star which never sets find this flame still burning. Christ, that morning star who came back from the dead and shed his peaceful light on all humanity, your Son, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen. My dear sisters and brothers, now that we have begun our solemn vigil, let us listen with quiet hearts to the Word of God. Let us meditate on how God, in times past, saved his people, and in these, the last days, has sent us his Son as our Redeemer. Let us pray that our God may complete this paschal work of salvation by the fullness of redemption. I would invite you at this time to carefully extinguish your candles and to just hold them upright for a moment until the wax solidifies. Please be seated.
A proclamation from the book of Genesis. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless wasteland, and darkness covered the abyss. while a mighty wind swept over the waters. Then God said,
"Let there be light."
And there was light. God saw how good the light was. God then separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. Thus evening came, and morning followed, the first day. Then God said,
"Let there be a dome in the middle of the waters to separate one body of water from the other."
And so it happened. God made the dome, and it separated the water from the dome from below it. God called the dome the sky. Evening came, and morning followed, the second day. Then God said,
"Let the water under the sky be gathered into a single basin, so that the dry land may appear."
And so it happened. The water under the sky was gathered into the basin, and the dry land appeared. God called the dry land the earth, and the basin of water he called the sea. God saw how good it was. Then God said,
"Let the earth bring forth vegetation, every kind of plant that bears seed, and every kind of fruit tree on earth that bears fruit with its seed in it."
And so it happened. The earth brought forth every kind of plant that bears seeds, and every kind of fruit tree on the earth that bears fruit with seeds in it. God saw how good it was. Evening came, morning followed, the third day. Then God said,
"Let there be lights in the dome of the sky to separate day from night. Let them mark the first times, the days and the years, and serve as luminaries in the dome of the sky to shed light upon the earth."
And so it happened. God made two great lights, the greater one to govern the day, and the lesser one to govern the night. And he made the stars. God set them into the dome of the sky to shed light upon the earth, to govern the day and the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. God saw how good it was. Evening came, and morning followed, the fourth day. Then God said,
"Let the water teem with an abundance of living creatures, and on the earth let birds fly beneath the dome of the sky."
And so it happened. God created the great sea monsters and all kinds of swimming creatures with which the water teems, and all kinds of winged birds. God saw how good it was, and God blessed them, saying,
"Be fertile, multiply, and fill the water of the seas, and let the birds multiply on the earth."
Evening came, and morning followed, the fifth day. Then God said,
"Let the earth bring forth all kinds of living creatures, cattle, creeping things, and wild animals of all kinds."
And so it happened. God made all kinds of wild animals, all kinds of cattle, and all kinds of creeping things on the earth. God saw how good it was. Then God said,
"Let us make people in our image, after our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and the cattle, and over all the wild animals and all creatures that crawl on the ground."
God created people in his image. In the divine image, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them, saying,
"Be fertile and multiply. Fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and all the living creatures that move on the earth."
God also said,
"See, I give you every seed-bearing plant all over the earth, and every tree that has seed-bearing fruit on it to be your food, and all the animals of the land, and all the birds of the air, and all the living creatures that crawl on the ground. I give all the green plants for food."
And so it happened. God looked at everything he had made, and he found it very good. Evening came, and morning followed, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth and all their array were completed. Since on the seventh day God was finished with the work that he had been doing, he rested on the seventh day from all of the work he had undertaken. The word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A proclamation from the book of Exodus.
The Lord said to Moses,
"Why are you crying out to me? Tell the Israelites to go forward, and you lift up your staff with your hand outstretched over the sea. Split the sea in two, so that the Israelites may pass through it on dry land. But I will make the Egyptians so obstinate that they will go in after them. Then I will receive glory through Pharaoh and all his army, his chariots and his charioteers. The Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord when I receive glory through Pharaoh and his chariots and charioteers."
Sing your song of freedom.
angel of God who had been leading Israel's camp now moved and went around behind them. The column of cloud also, leaving the front, took up its place behind them, so that it came between the camp of Egyptians and that of Israel. But the cloud now became dark, and thus the night passed without the rival camps coming closer together all night long. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord swept the sea with a strong east wind throughout the night, and so it turned into dry land. When the water was thus divided, the Israelites marched into the midst of the sea on dry land, with the water like the wall on their right and to the left. The Egyptians followed in pursuit. All of Pharaoh's horses and charioteers went after them into the midst of the sea. In the night watch, just before the dawn, the Lord cast through the column of the fiery cloud upon the Egyptian force a glance that threw it into a panic. And so he clogged their chariot wheels, and they could hardly drive. With that, the Egyptians sounded the retreat before Israel, because the Lord was fighting for them against the Egyptians.
Then the Lord told Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea, that the water may flow back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and their charioteers."
Moses stretched his hand over the sea, and at dawn the sea flowed back to its normal depth. The Egyptians were fleeing head on towards the sea when the Lord hurled them into its midst.
As the water flowed back, it covered the chariots and the charioteers of Pharaoh's whole army, which had followed the Israelites into the sea. Not a single one of them escaped. But the Israelites had marched on dry land through the midst of the sea, with water like a wall to the right and to their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel on that day from the power of the Egyptians.
When Israel saw the Egyptians lying dead on the seashore, and behold the great power that the Lord had shown against the Egyptians, they feared the Lord and believed in him and in his servant Moses. Then Moses and the Israelites sang this song to the Lord.
Sing a song. Thank you.
The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. O God, whose ancient wonders remain undimmed in splendor even in our day, for what you once bestowed on a single people, freeing them from Pharaoh's persecution by the power of your right hand, now you bring about as the salvation of the nations through the waters of rebirth. Grant, we pray, that the whole world may become children of Abraham and inherit the dignity of Israel's birthright. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
A proclamation from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, all of you who are thirsty, come to the water. You who have no money, come, receive grain and eat. Come without paying and without cost. Drink wine and milk. Why spend your money for what is not bread, your wages for what fails to satisfy? Heed me, and you shall eat well. You shall delight in rich fare. Come to me heedfully. Listen, that you may have life. I will renew with you the everlasting covenant, the benefits assured to David, as I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and a commander of nations. So shall you summon a nation you knew not, and nations that knew you not shall run to you. Because the Lord our God, the Holy One of Israel, was glorified for you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call him when he is near. Let the scoundrel forsake his way and the wicked man his thoughts. Let him turn to the Lord for mercy, to our God, who is generous in forgiving. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are my ways your ways, says the Lord. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so high are my ways above your ways, and my thoughts above your thoughts. For just as from the heavens the rain and the snow come down, and do not return there till they have watered the earth, making it fertile and fruitful, giving seed to the one who sows and bread to the one who eats. So shall my word that goes forth from my mouth, my word shall not return to me void, but shall do my will, achieving the end for which I sent. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, sole hope of the world, who by the preaching of your prophets unveiled the mysteries of this present age, graciously increase the longing of your people, for only at the prompting of your grace do the faithful progress in any kind of virtue. Through Christ our Lord.
A proclamation from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. The word of the Lord came to me saying, Son of man, when the house of Israel lived in their land, they defiled it by their contacts, by their conduct, and their deeds. Therefore, I poured out my fury upon them. Because of the blood that they poured out on the ground, and because they defiled it with idols, I scattered among them the nations, dispersing them over foreign lands. According to their conduct and deeds, I judged them. But when they came among the nations, wherever they came, they served to profane my name. Because it was said of them, these are the people of the Lord, yet they had to leave their land. So I have relented because of my holy name. Therefore say to the house of Israel, thus says the Lord, not for your sakes do I act, house of Israel, but for the sake of my holy name. I will prove the holiness of my great name, thus the nation shall know that I am the Lord, when in their sight I prove my holiness through you. For I will take you away from among the nations, gather you from all the foreign land. I will sprinkle clean water upon you to cleanse you from all your impurities. And from all your idols I will cleanse you. I will give you a new heart and place a new spirit within you, taking away from your bodies your stony hearts and giving you natural hearts. I will put my spirit within you and make you live by my statutes, careful to observe my decrees. You shall live in the land I gave your fathers. You shall be my people, and I will be your God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O God of unchanging power and eternal light, look with favor on the wondrous mystery of the whole church, and serenely accomplish the work of human salvation, which you planned from all eternity. May the whole world know and see that what was cast down is raised up, what had become old is made new, and all things are restored to integrity through Christ, just as by him they came into being, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
We pray for a moment in the quiet of our hearts. O God, who makes this most sacred night radiant with the glory of the Lord's resurrection, stir up in your church a spirit of adoption, so that renewed in body and mind, we may render you undivided service through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
a proclamation from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Are you unaware that we who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were indeed buried with him through our baptism into death, so that just as Christ Jesus was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live in newness for life. For if we have grown in union with him through death like his, we shall also be united with him in the resurrection. We know that our old self was crucified with him, so that our sinful body might be done away with, that we may no longer be slaves to sin. For a dead person has been absolved from sin. If then we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. We know that Christ, raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has power over him. The word of the Lord. Thank you.
My sisters and brothers, the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Proclamation of the Holy Gospel according to the tradition of Matthew. After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven, approached, rolled back the stone, and sat upon it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing was white as snow. The guards were shaken for fear of him and became like dead men. The angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid. I know you are seeking Jesus the crucified. He is not here. He has been raised just as he said. Come and see the place where they lay him. Then quickly go and tell his disciples, he has been raised from the dead, and he is going before you to Galilee. And there you will see him. Behold, I have told you." Then they went quickly away from the tomb, fearful, yet overjoyed. And they ran to announce this to his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them on their way, and he greeted them. They approached, embraced his feet, and did him homage. And Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me."
For this good news we say to the Lord.
I'm wondering if you can see me or not. Deacon Mike, when he has incense, you never know what's going to happen. I know he likes to use incense, but he doesn't pay for it either, so he's very generous with the use of incense. If you haven't caught on to the theme, and of course there'll probably be many themes of this evening's celebration, I would think the outstanding theme would be the word transformation. Transformation. Not just change, not just transition, but transformation, something profound. In nature, all of us are experiencing now, we said finally, the grip of winter, that strong, terrible, frigid grip of winter has let go. Our lakes are freed. Snow, I saw one patch of snow today yet, if you would believe it, is still around. But it's leaving, and now we're beginning to see patches of green. And soon, we'll see flowers and vegetation and all the good signs that come with spring. That's one transformation in nature. But we're here for more important transformations, and that would be a transformation, for example, from sadness to joy, from fear now to trust and courage, from Lent, that 40-day period of fasting, prayer, abstinence, concern for the poor, now to a season of joy, rejoicing in the thought of resurrection. And so the important transformation we're talking about tonight
is not from life to death, but is the transformation from death to life. We're talking, of course, about our Lord's transformation after having been on the cross and then in the tomb for 3 days. Now he is alive. Our world today is filled with many skeptics. People used to say, well, I'm from Missouri, you must prove it. We have a lot of Missourians around today. People who, unless it's there in some scientific, historical way as a proof, they might believe. But then I have a feeling that even then they will not believe. And the reason for that is that faith is different. Faith is based upon knowledge, but it's more than knowledge. It's a gift that comes from the Holy Spirit. It's a gift that's given to us, and as a gift, we are free to accept it or we're free to reject it. And many we know reject it. Fortunately, many more accept and grasp this gift we call faith, because that's what it is. It is a gift. And so it's not against human reason that we're asked to believe. That would be wrong. We must believe what is reasonable. And God, in a certain way, paves the course to belief. He doesn't simply say, well, you must now believe. For example, if you take the Gospel of John, he doesn't have a lot of miracles like you have in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Miracles help as well. But he has what he calls seven signs. And each one of these, if we look at it closely, has the same purpose, and that is to lead people to faith, faith in Jesus, and to prepare them and to prepare us for that seventh and most important sign is what we celebrate tonight, Jesus' resurrection from the dead. So it is then that we have the first miracle. I'm not going to go through all of them, believe me, but we have the changing of water into wine at Cana of Galilee, Jesus' first indication that what he does, nobody else really is able to do. And he does it because his mother asks him to do it. And then she turns around and says to the servants and to all of us, do what he tells you. She's telling us, listen to him, do what he tells you. And we go on. There's a man who was lame, and he was cured by our Lord. There was Lazarus, who died. Our Lord could have been there earlier. He had found out about him. Lazarus was like a brother to him, Mary and Martha like sisters to him. He could have been there earlier. You say, why? Why? Because he cured so many other people. Why wasn't he there when they needed him? He couldn't understand it. In fact, they were angry. Lord, why weren't you here when we needed you? And he avoided that question. Instead, he asked them a question. And he said, do you believe in the resurrection of the dead? And they said, well, yes. Then, as so often, like the woman at the well, he lifts them up to a whole other level, saying, do you believe that I am the resurrection and the life? Do you believe that I am the resurrection and the life? That's entirely different. They knew him. He was like a brother to them. And he was asking them, do you believe that I am the resurrection and the life for you, for Lazarus, for all people? And I can't imagine Martha and Mary answering, oh, yes, Lord. They had to ponder that. And finally, their faith brought them to be able to say, yes, Lord, we do believe. That's why we're here. That's why we're here. Lord asks us the same question. Do you believe? And we wouldn't be here tonight if we didn't believe in the resurrection of the Lord. But there's a further belief beyond that one we know that concerns ourselves. We believe as he was the resurrection and life for Lazarus and for other people, he'll be the same for us, the very same thing. Proofs? No. Indications? Yes. All kinds of them. Miracles? Yes. God's grace at work in our lives? Yes. I see it in my own life, and I'm sure you too, if you reflect upon the many things that happen in our lives, we can't help but see the hand of God at work in our lives. That's what leads us to faith, and that's why we're here this evening. And so it is then, and I mentioned it already, that we've finished a very important time of the year, 40 days of serious consideration in terms of what must I do to become that better person? What must I do to become more like Christ? 40 days to think about that. 40 days to work upon that. 40 days to die to that, whatever it may be, so that tonight we can come and celebrate new life already. We've got something to celebrate in addition to the fact that we look forward to our own resurrection. We're here tonight to celebrate something that is new life already, that we took seriously during this 40-day journey. And now we're here tonight to commit ourselves publicly, each one of us, to say, yes, Lord, I do believe. I'm here to follow you all the way, not just to Calvary, but all the way. And so in a few moments, we're going to bless the water, water that will be used throughout the year to bring new members into our midst. That's what we've always done in the church, through the waters of baptism. We're going to take that same water, and we're going to bless ourselves. We know how important water is for life. Without that, we can live without food for quite a while. We can't live without water for very long, and especially the water that we're speaking about here, the baptismal water. An important part of that, too, is the willingness on our part to renew our baptismal promises. People did that for us a long time ago, our sponsors. We were infants, and they spoke on our behalf. But it's important for us as adults, often, every year, and then during the year, to renew those baptismal promises where we reject Satan and all the works of Satan and everything connected with Satan in order to say that we are committed to Christ. And so in a few moments, we'll be able to do that. And so, yes, we're here to celebrate transformations. And in a few days, hopefully, spring will be here. And as we celebrate spring, we'll come back to this evening and think about the important transformation that has already taken place as we celebrate our Lord's life, death, and resurrection, and our own promise of resurrection someday with him. Thank you. Sure.
Please rise. Please turn to page 9 for the responses, for the blessing of the water, and our profession of faith. God of all mercy, through these waters of baptism, you have filled us with new life as your very own children.
Blessed are you, O God.
Blessed are you, O God.
From all who are baptized in water and the Holy Spirit, you have formed one people, united in your Son, Jesus Christ.
Blessed are you, O God.
Blessed are you, O God.
You have set us free and filled our hearts with the spirit of your love, that we may live in your peace.
Blessed are you, O God.
Blessed are you, O God.
You call those who have been baptized to announce the good news of Jesus Christ to people everywhere.
Blessed are you, O God.
Blessed are you, O God.
You call your people to this cleansing water and new birth, that by sharing the faith of your church, we may have eternal life. Bless this water in which many will be baptized. We ask this in the name of Jesus the Lord. We will once again share the light of Christ with our tapers for the renewal of our baptismal promises. Brothers and sisters, through the Paschal mystery, we have been buried with Christ in baptism, so that we may walk with him in newness of life. And so now that our Lenten observance has concluded, let us renew the promises of holy baptism, by which we once renounced Satan and his works, and promised to serve God in the Holy Catholic Church. And once again, page 9 is your response for the renewal of our baptismal promises.
This is our faith.
renewed our baptismal promises, and now we have the opportunity to encounter the fresh Easter water, blessing ourselves and renewing new life in Christ. So after the liturgical ministers bless themselves, we'll return to our places, and we invite you to follow the direction of the ushers to encounter the baptismal waters.
And we will continue singing verse 2.
You may extinguish your candles. Pray, friends, that these are gifts, the many gifts of Easter, may all be acceptable to God, our loving Father. Amen. Filled with Easter joy, O Lord, we offer you the sacrifice by which your church is wonderfully reborn and is nourished with the food of life. We make our prayer through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty, our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but on this night, above all, to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed. For he is the true Lamb who has taken away the sin of the world. By dying, he has destroyed our death. By rising, restored our life. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise. Even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, with Jerome, our bishop, and all the clergy.
Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him.
With the words Jesus taught us, we pray that these Easter days might further God's reign in this world.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, now and forever. Amen.
And may the peace of the risen one be with you always.
And with your spirit. Let us share with one another a sign of Christ's peace.
Behold the Lamb of God, slain and risen for us all. How blessed are we called to this Easter banquet.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but always say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus bring us to life everlasting.
Thank you.
I invite forward the ministers of communion for the homebound. It's very valuable that you're able to bring the Eucharist to those who can't be here, for they too need the reassurance of the presence of the risen Lord, and that they also are a part of bearing his light to others. And so we send you with our prayer for them. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Just a word about a project we started a couple of weeks ago that is to kind of carry over Lent into the Easter season. Yes, please be seated. Some of you may not have been here when we began that a couple weeks ago, so I want to just update you about it. We've begun this little notebook project, and if you didn't get a notebook, there are some in the pews, so please feel free to take one if you didn't get yours. And the idea of the notebooks is that in the course of the Mass, just sort of keep alert and kind of ask yourself this question: what one thing can I take with me from this Mass throughout the rest of the week that will help me to be a better version of myself? One thing, one experience, one phrase, something from our celebration of the Eucharist that will help me be a better version of myself in the coming week, and then just jot it down in here. And so if you're new to the project, you're welcome to begin it tonight. Feel free to grab a notebook, and we'll usually just take a moment at this time of the Mass to jot down in our notebook that one thing that will help me be a better version of myself. So we'll just take a moment for that. Filled with Easter joy, O Lord, we ask that you watch over your church with unfailing care, that we who have received new life through the Paschal mystery of Christ may come to the glory of the resurrection. Grant this through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
I just want to thank all of you for coming this evening, for participating. I think this is really a wonderful turnout of so many of you coming together to celebrate in this most solemn way the resurrection of the Lord. And just a word of gratitude on behalf of the entire parish to all the many people that gave of their time, their talent, their energies, their creativity to put together such beautiful Easter celebrations. I imagine some of you perhaps have never been in our historic chapel. The historic chapel is equally well appointed for the Easter season, and it's open every day, so you might want to stop in and take a look. We're very blessed to have that smaller worship space connected to our parish history as well. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Mass is ended. Go in peace. Alleluia.